please give a very warm welcome to Karmenu Vella, who is European Commissioner for the Environment, Maritime Affairs and Fisheries. So, Commissioner, over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Stephen. And I have to say it is a pleasure for me to be here. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank Norway for this organization and for their hospitality. So let me start by saying that normally I am not an alarmist, but we have heard enough this morning to realize that climate change in the Arctic is a real cause and a big cause for concern. And as has already been mentioned, the region is warming twice as fast as the rest of the world. And each and every year seems to bring more bad news. This matters, in particular, for the 4 million people who live here and who feel the effects of climate change every day. But the impacts of a changing Arctic are also felt across the whole globe, with rising sea levels, ocean temperatures, and modified weather patterns, for example. And that is why the European Union is totally engaged in the Arctic. As inhabitants of our common planet, it is also our responsibility to act. With the Paris Agreement, the world has promised to combat climate change. With the Sustainable Development Goals, we have pledged to use shared resources and our oceans responsibly. Now, it is time to make this happen. In April, the European Union launched an integrated policy for the Arctic, focusing on three main areas. First, responding to climate change and safeguarding the Arctic environment. Second, strengthening cooperation with our Arctic partners. And third, promoting sustainable development. Our commitment to sustainable development recognizes that the Arctic is a place where people live and study and work. These people will want to make the most of the region's potential to pursue innovation and smart growth with respect for the Arctic's fragile environment. And there is an enormous potential for the green and the blue economy to thrive. Nature tourism has taken off in Iceland, for example, and in Lapland. European companies are developing sustainable cold climate technologies and testing these technologies in the Arctic. The award-winning Circular Ocean Project, to take another example, is looking into new ways of processing, recycling, and repurposing marine plastic waste. The European Union is backing such businesses and such business initiatives. Our European Fund for Regional Development will invest more than 1 billion euros in the north of Sweden and Finland by the year 2020. We are also supporting Arctic-related research, having set aside 40 million euros for 2016 and 2017 alone. And we are working to safeguard the Arctic environment, both on land and at sea. As announced in last year's circular economy package, we will propose an EU strategy on plastics, including marine litter. We will continue to support the establishment of marine protected areas, including in high seas. We have allocated 1.5 million euros to a new initiative addressing black carbon emissions, focusing on issues like gas flaring, domestic heating, and maritime shipping. Finally, we have included the Arctic within the European Union's recent initiative for better international ocean governance. For instance, by implementing the International Polar Code, which entered into force on 1st of January, or by continuing to work for an international agreement to prevent unregulated fisheries in the central Arctic Ocean. One last point, if I may. As the challenges we face become more complex, communication and cooperation become even more important. The annual dialogue with Arctic indigenous peoples we have had now for several years has been a major element in designing our new Arctic policy. It will remain an essential part of our future engagement. Our new Arctic Stakeholder Forum, which will have a session later on today, gives all interested parties a chance to tell us how we can improve the effectiveness of the EU funding. And in September, the European Union and 25 science ministers adopted a joint statement for a new collective approach in Arctic science. The bottom line is this: achieving an Arctic that is both sustainable and prosperous is up to all of us and all of us working together. So I look forward to our discussions today, and I do hope to continue our conversation and to start acting and implementing in the future. To that aim, we will work with Finland as the incoming chair of the Arctic Council to jointly organize a high-level event on the EU Arctic policy in Finland coming June. Furthermore, the EU will be hosting the next Our Ocean Conference in Malta in October, and this will be yet another occasion to continue work on protecting and valuing our oceans with key stakeholders and policymakers from all over the globe. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. Well, we've had all sorts of talk already today about cooperation and multilateral organizations, obviously, at the heart of that. Well, the Atlantic Council is one of them. The Arctic Council, forgive me, is one of them. Another very important organization that we need to hear from is the International Maritime Organization. I'm delighted to say the Secretary General is with us today, Kitak Lim. Welcome, Mr. Lim.
Good morning, all distinguished participants, and particularly very excellent moderator from London. I'm personally extremely honored and happy to be here with you to attend this very prestigious occasion, which is held in a very beautiful city of Tromsø. It is the first time for me to be in this area, but since last night, I'm enjoying a lot of snow, all snow out there. And I believe there has been a lot of development for the last 20 years in terms of activity by the Arctic Council. There is no doubt that economic development and increasing commercial activity in the Arctic region are emerging in terms of economic consideration and environmental consideration, and also geopolitical consideration as well. The International Maritime Organization is one of the specialized agency under United Nations umbrella. IMO is handled in charge of the safety of ships and marine protection, which preventing any pollution activities from international shipping. And also we are dealing with the efficiency of the international shipping. And now we are taking out of the security issue as well. At the IMO, our interest is maritime activities, but our role is not to debate whether or not increased maritime activity is desirable. Our role is to ensure that the ships and the people which do operate in the Arctic area are safe and that their impact on the environment is minimal. The safety of ships operating in the harsh and remote and the vulnerable polar area, Arctic area particularly, and the protection of the pristine environment have always been a matter of a concern for International Maritime Organization. And there have been major in place that specifically addressed operation in polar regions for several years. However, with more and more ships navigating in Arctic waters, IMO has moved to address international concern about the protection of the polar environment and the safety of the seafarers and the passengers with the introduction of a new regulation that all ships operating in these harsh and challenging waters must comply with. The mandatory polar code for ships operating in Arctic and Antarctic waters entered into force 1st January this year. It is the single most important initiative to establish appropriate safety and environment regulation for polar shipping as a matter of the mandatory convention and regulation. It is important to remember that the polar code requirements go above and beyond those of existing IMO convention and regulations in terms of safety and protection of marine environment. But the polar code adds, and as I mentioned, additional layer on top, specifically for ships operating in this area. The Polar Code set out mandatory standards that cover the full range of design and construction equipment, operational training, and train of people, and environmental protection matters that apply to ships operating in the waters surrounding the two poles. Among the code's mandatory safety requirements are protective thermal clothing, ice removal equipment, and includes lifeboat, and ability to ensure visibility in ice, freezing, rain, and snow conditions. The regulation extended to the material used to build ships intended for polar operation, and all tankers under the code will have to have double hulls. From an environment perspective, the code prohibits or stricter limit discharge of oil and chemicals, sewage, garbage, food, waste, and many other substantial, including litters. Ladies and gentlemen, Polar Code will provide a strong regime to minimize the impact of a shipping operation on the pristine polar region. It will also make operating in this water safer, helping to protect the life of crew and the passenger ships. One last comment I'd like to mention is I have been observing the activities of our Arctic Council. I have observed, particularly for the last years, Arctic Council becomes more open to outside. Based on consideration, the Arctic Council issues becoming international, not only regional. So in terms of activity, I'm very concerned about, I'm very interested in communication with the Arctic Council. We like to increase, promote collaboration, the activity between Arctic Council and our organization, together with the other international organizations like WMO. We are ready to do so. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Lim. Thank you very much. Well, we've talked a lot about the sort of internationalization of Arctic issues. Let's be ambitious. Let's not just confine ourselves to planet Earth. Let's think about the skies and the space above planet Earth for a second, because the European Space Agency has important sort of things to bring to this particular conference and an insight and experience that we can tap into. So do, on that basis, give a very warm welcome to Jan Werner, who's the Director General of the European Space Agency. Jan, welcome.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much, and welcome. It's a pleasure for me, of course, and the motto of my speech will be white space meets outer space. So I take the subject, not only blue, but also outer space, which is rather dark. And in fact, space is now really facing all these different issues. And you see here on the left-hand side a lot of subjects, and all of them are directly linked to the Arctic discussion. So everything, even human spaceflight, if you have a question concerning that, I can go into detail later on. So we are discussing here, and this was also somewhat I got in the preparation, about links between different areas. So what we have, first of all, to make a link, is a link from basic research really to the market, to public applications in a very broad sense. And as we learned today, this is also linked to the change with regard to industry. And more we go to the right-hand side of this picture, we have more and more commercial activities. And therefore, space and white space, outer space, everything is now linked also to commercialization, also in a positive sense. I understood the balance of this morning very well. But there is more to be done. And this is a link not only in the horizontal way, but also in the vertical way, meaning to combine, cross-fertilize the different areas, space and other areas, agriculture, etc. So cross-fertilization is of utmost importance in this respect. And there are a lot of subjects, and I cannot go through all of them, but there is science. For instance, from outer space, we can look into the Earth and see the internal jet stream of the iron, which of course has an influence on the magnetic field, which of course has an influence also on the Arctic region. So there is an interaction from outer space to the core of Earth and then back to what we call, what was called this morning, the cap of the Earth. We have, of course, telecommunications. Telecommunications is always a worldwide activity if we take satellites, and we can, in the future, also facilitate technological leaps with ESA's activities. We do mega constellation preparations, and of course, public-private partnership and communications, telecommunication especially, is of vital importance for the Arctic region. Satellite navigation, of course, we have the Galileo initial services right now, and satellite navigation, when we are talking about ships passing new routes, etc., satellite navigation is important, and therefore space is also active in that field. And all of this is usually bringing data together. People are talking about big data, sometimes in the wrong way, saying big data means a lot of data. Then we would call it a lot of data, but big data is the fusion of data coming from different sources, and I took a little bit more southern example over here, it's Hawaii, and you see this is the highest mountain of the world, and you cannot do it by just one satellite or by one other instrument. You need to couple different instruments from below the seawater level and above. So this is information coming from a satellite, and this are informations coming from sub-sea level sensors. So to bring them together, and this is also what we have to do in the Arctic region. We learned about the Paris Agreement several times today, and what is very important, more than 50% of all these variables describing the climate change can be and maybe only observed from space. So all the different changes in the atmosphere, etc. And we can do all of this, and we call this also a climate change initiative. And of course, by that, we can also observe the change of the ice shield of the Arctic. And here you see only a small part of that. The story is much too long to show it to you in my limited time. But you see that something is changing, and this is data over several years, the data from satellites, so you can really see the change of the whole ice cap, not only in length and width, but also in the thickness. We can measure that from space. We heard about pollution, especially from possible pollution also from ships. I have here a little bit dramatic example. This is from Deepwater Horizon, this rig which was damaged. And you see from space we can immediately recognize the change of the oil film on the surface of the sea. This is by radar technology, as we can show it. CO2 emission, this is not only to avoid CO2 emission, this is the best one, but the second is to control it, to have monitor it, to give people the information. Here is a special CO2 source, and we have to fight against it, and we are working on that, having a satellite also for very concrete CO2 emission monitoring. And sea level rise, of course. And I come back to the conference in Paris, and there was Mr. Kerry. You know him, so he's now out of his position, and he made a very nice quote, which I would like to quote over here, and he said, "Now I know there are still a few who insist that climate change is just a big hoax, even a political conspiracy. My friends, these people are so out of touch with science that they believe rising sea levels don't matter, because in their view, the extra water is just going to spill out over the sides of a flat Earth." With that, I come to my final picture. No, it's not in the time you applaud. So, therefore, white space meets outer space. That means for me expanding the frontiers of knowledge, assisting decision and policymakers in sectoral policies. All different areas are covered, enabling growth. But for me, it's also very important to inform the public, to make them aware of what is happening. So this can be done by space information, very nice. And it's, of course, about inspiring and motivating. And by the way, for the people who need always the return of investment by money, yes, €1 invested in space creates at least €6 in economic return. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Great. Don't you think it would be great for all politicians just to have to look at the Earth from space from time to time? It gives you a slightly different perspective. And some politicians, and I can't think who I'm thinking of, but they seem to be somewhat obsessed with themselves, and perhaps a bigger picture would help them. Anyway, thank you, Jan, for that. Our next speaker, and we've got two more, and then we're going to have our panel discussions. Our next speaker is Daniel Paoli. He's from the University of British Columbia in Canada. Daniel, welcome to you.
Ladies and gentlemen, as you can see from my tan, I'm not a trop, an Arctic person. I have worked mainly in the tropics, in tropical developing countries, half of my career. And what I experienced there, I work on fisheries, is that there was no communication between the science and the policy making. We are talking about developing countries, and maybe that's a characteristic of developing countries. And in 94, I went to Canada. I became a professor there. And this was right after the collapse of the northern cod, a sub-Arctic species. And this had really affected the country. The country was searching for an explanation of what had happened. And what had happened is the same thing. The scientists were not listened because political directive were more important than the science on the ground. And I realized that many developed countries have the same syndrome of not listening to the scientists. Actually, I'm pleased to say that this is not the case in Norway. Norway has extraordinarily well-run fisheries, and so does the US. The main point is that the stocks are being rebuilt. And rebuilding stocks is something that has to happen throughout the world, but it's actually done in a very few countries, and very few countries have legislation to do that. The European Union has passed legislation that is now being sabotaged. There is not really a strong rebuilding mandate, but there is one in the US. And with this rebuilding, you can undo some of the damage that the fisheries have done as they were unlashed on the stocks of the world, including the stock of the Arctic and subarctic. Because a natural resource, such as fish, can actually produce 5-10% equivalent of an interest rate. But actually what we want to extract from them is far more than that. And usually the rate of exploitation is far superior to what the stock can produce. That is the lack of sustainability. So the result of this, of us throwing industrial might at stocks that cannot stand it, is actually that fisheries expand, and they expand wherever they can, and they have, in the course of the years, and I'm one of the few persons to study fishery as a global system. You can see fisheries expanding from the North Atlantic and North Asia to cover the world, and now the Arctic is open. It's going to be open, and our fishery is going to expand in it. An out-of-control fisheries, or not well-controlled fishery, can liquidate a stock within 10 to 15 years, and that's usually what happens, and then they move on. And because this pattern is still the case in the majority of countries, we have now, because the world is finite, and the fisheries have gotten to the edge of the world. We have now declining catches. Declining catches since 96. And I'm worried when I hear, as I have seen in the document, that it is that the Arctic is going to be the great source of fish and is going to be a food chamber, I read. That was in a document of the conference, a huge food chamber. China is more explicit about that. It talks about a granary for China. There is not an hope, a chance in hell that we will feed the world, 10 million people, with fish from the Arctic, because if it's caught in the Arctic, it's going to be much too expensive for people in Africa and Latin America. So I think there might be lots of reasons or pretexts to move into the Arctic with fisheries that they always expand, but please not to feed the world, because it's a lie. This is not going to be done. Finally, I will have the opportunity this afternoon to talk about fisheries and global warming, so I will not talk about it. But in principle, we know what we do, what we need to do for fisheries, and all we need to do is to do it, which is to maintain the fisheries small enough that they don't need to expand. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. And I think making those connections between science and policy making is very much what this session is about. So thank you for putting that context on it. Our last speaker before we get to our panel discussions, ladies and gentlemen, is Paul Denbol from the Aalborg University here in Denmark. And welcome to you, Professor Denbol. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think I'll start out challenging some of the things which were mentioned earlier today. There's been several mentions of striking the balance between sustainable use and conservation. And I think I will actually challenge that and basically say that for those issues where I've been involved, it's one and the same. There's no balance to be stricken there, because you cannot have sustainable use if it's not based on proper conservation of the marine ecosystems. So it's the same thing. And if you cannot find a way to do it in a sustainable way, then don't do it. It's as simple as that. I think the real contradiction is between short-termism and long-termism. And that's a policy choice which has to be made all the time in all decision-making. And I respect that. But it's not between the balance between sustainable use and conservation. My background is in fisheries science, mainly environmental, marine environmental science, as actually the building the bridge between international science and policy making, where I have been working for several years as the head of the advice in the International Council for the Exploration of the Sea, which is providing the science basis for fisheries management and a lot of the environmental management in the Northeast Atlantic and into the Arctic Ocean. And basically, I can say that the status of that is that there's been a lot of progress since the early zeros in the situation for the fish stocks in the Northeast Atlantic, including the Barents Sea, so that in the Barents Sea, for instance, nearly all the fish stocks have now been rebuilt to the target where we want them to be. There are a few exceptions, but basically this is what has happened. And the reason for this is that we have had management plans in place, that there's been policy decisions made, that now we need to have a plan for how we will decide in the future, and then following up on that. But, and there's a but here, an ecosystem approach has not been fully implemented. This has been done in the old-fashioned way on a stock-by-stock basis. And this is not sustainable, because fisheries, fish stocks, and the human beings operating in them are dependent on the human ecosystem which they operate in. And we must maintain the health of that ecosystem. And that has not been a large part of the equation. So we need to do that more, to integrate much more with an ecosystem approach, including to integrate with environmental policies in the region. One reason that this has there has also been setbacks in the process in spite of these long-term management plans being decided, then there is still a tendency to put political pressure, lobbyism, on actually circumventing these decisions. And you still see ministers coming back from negotiations in triumph, saying that we managed to get a higher quota than what the management plan, which we ourselves as ministers has decided, actually said we should have. And this is short-termism, which I'm actually quite disappointed to see after the good experiences we had in making these management plans and recover stocks and rebuild stocks for the benefit of the fisheries themselves. So I think that we need to be very, very, very aware of that and to maintain that good spirit of sticking to the management plans we have set out and also for the future. For the Arctic, we are in a situation where it's a sensitive ecosystem, it's a vulnerable ecosystem, and we have not started really to get into it yet, except for the Barents Sea, where there's more or less sustainable use in place. And we need to be sure that if and when fisheries are expanding into the area, that it's done in a gradual way, in a small steps at a time, that it's properly monitored and evaluated also, including the wider ecosystem impacts of this. This is a huge task, it's a costly task, and I think that there is a big role for industry to actually take on a lot of the responsibility in doing this, to actually document that when we are expanding this, then it is done in a responsible way where we are taking a long-term view. And I think it's important to get that role on board. So I think there is a challenge in the future for governments and for industries to do this responsibly. And on the legal side, it is necessary in the meantime to make sure that there are interim measures in place which will prevent any illegal, unregulated expansion which is not governed by the basic principle of only do this gradually and adapt when you get knowledge about the impacts of what you are doing and stop if those impacts are not acceptable anymore. So these are the things which has to be addressed in the future for utilizing the resources of the Arctic Ocean. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Okay. So, Professor Dembol, if you take a seat, I think you're going to be in one of these seats here, and we're going to invite other panelists to come forward. So, panel, for the first session of this double-headed session, if you would take your seats, and Maria will help you to find your seats, and we'll go straight into a debate, so don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. All of our panelists have spoken except for one, so I shall introduce you to her in just a moment. So if we've all got our seats, and I think we have, marvelous. Okay, so as I said, ladies and gentlemen, we've met all of our panelists in this panel except for one. So please give a warm welcome to Silje Holm-Zindahl, who is Director of Sustainability at Aker Biomarine, which is a company which does biomass research and development and actually, it turns out, supplies Norwegian fish farms with krill-based food products from, guess where, Antarctic. So we'll talk a little bit about that. But please give all of our panel a warm hand. So we've got a nice mix here of sort of politicians, if I can call an EU commissioner a politician, I think I can. And we've got academic input, and we've got some business input as well. So I'm going to start with you, if I might, Commissioner. It seems to me, if we're particularly talking about the fisheries aspect of the oceans and ocean economic activity and exploitation, there's a degree of satisfaction that things in the Arctic aren't too bad. The Barents Sea is a success story. Norway's very proud of its record. But we've also heard that, you know, fish stocks in general across the world are under pressure, and therefore there's always a tendency to expand fisheries, and they will inevitably want to expand into the Arctic. Are you happy that when it comes to Europe, the Europeans are not just simply going to seek to move into the Arctic in a big way and behave, frankly, in an irresponsible, unsustainable fashion?
Well, first of all, I have to start by saying that within Europe, we do have control measures. We do have a common fisheries policy, which is giving us results because we have the number of stocks, which is at MSY level, has gone from 9 to 34, and we have a target to have all stocks at MSY level by 2020. When it comes to the Arctic and dealing between fisheries and science, what we are promoting is the idea that there should be no fishing whatsoever in the Arctic waters unless, and fishing could only take place if and when there is enough scientific advice underpinning fishing. So, and this has been agreed by the Arctic member states as well. So for the time being, hopefully, there will be no fishing unless and only when there is scientific advice to support it.
Right. That is, on one level, very concrete and clear, but on another level, there is that word unless. So it's a bit of a weasel word in that it could be manipulated. Is it going to be manipulated? I mean, you might turn to some science which says, oh, it's fine, we've looked at the sustainability issues, the Arctic can stand some fishing, while a whole heap of other scientists may disagree completely. So how are you going to decide?
No, first of all, I don't think that the fisheries industry and the CFP in Europe is being manipulated. I don't think so. I think we do have a number of responsible and genuine fishermen. On the other hand, we have the IUUs as well. And this is becoming a very big concern because globally, IUU accounts for some 15% of global fishing. Just to give you an idea how big this is, Europe fishes 5% of global catches. So IUU worldwide is three times as much as the total European catches. So it's one thing cooperating and discussing quotas and so on, but it's another thing going out to stop and eradicate IUU. So I think, yes, and we're trying to cover this. We're pushing a lot, and we're taking the lead on a global ocean governance. Mm. We're discussing, and we're getting a lot of support with the US, with China, South America. We have launched our own ocean governance initiative.
I'm just trying to imagine what Donald Trump will say when he first hears the phrase global ocean governance.
We're wondering that as well, so let's see what's going to happen. But with or without Donald Trump,
does it involve black helicopters? No.
But I'm certain that everyone's intention, including China and so on, is to go ahead with or without Trump.
Yeah. Well, let's not make everything about Trump, because that would not be fun, would it? Cecilia, you had your hand up, and we'd love to hear from you, because we haven't heard from you yet.
I think I could give an example that would actually support the case of that type of governance of the Arctic, because we have the Antarctic Treaty, and CAMLR, the Commission for the Living Antarctic Resources, near the South Pole, that works in the same way, that it's based on science, and you cannot increase any quota of fishing unless scientists or the research community
and that really
approves
works.
It really works.
By the way, where are you from?
I was born in this city.
Right, so how come you're doing all your work in the Antarctic, you traitor?
I think, and it comes back to also the status of the fish quota stocks globally. And with 75% of the fish stocks either overfished or fished to its capacity, I think it's important to look to a broader sense of the biomasses we have out there to supply us with the omega-3s we need both in farm fish but also in our diets.
Right, so this is fascinating. So we are talking about ensuring that the waters of the Arctic and indeed Antarctic are not subject to unsustainable overfishing or indeed, in many cases, any fishing at all. And yet you're out there with your company harvesting in Antarctica. So just tell us a little bit about how you can be so sure, because this is relevant to the Arctic, how you can be so sure that what you're doing is indeed sustainable and compatible with the science.
So back to what Daniel I was saying about not fishing any more than the species itself could recruit. Mm. So normal, when you have precaution in a fishery, you would say you would fish 10% of the biomass. In the Antarctic and for krill, we only fish 0.5%.
Mm. Right. Well, we've got two profs here who both live and eat and breathe this stuff.
Can I say something about that? First of all, there is a process that can be described, again, globally, of fishing down. We go after the big things, and then we go down. And it is...
Sorry, are you talking about the oceanic food chain?
Yeah.
We go so you down. Start with the big stuff, whales, and you end up with krill.
You end up with krill. Right. So that is scraping the bottom of the barrel.
Yeah.
That is a good example of it. We are, in many places, scraping the bottom of the barrel. They, in the Med, you can see them catching tiny fish. In Southeast Asia, this is also the case. And Antarctica, krill, it's part of this.
Are you saying Cecilia shouldn't be doing what she's doing?
I'm saying that, and I'm saying a second thing. There is an enormous amount of krill in the Antarctica. It's spread all around it. And say there is 1 million tons. There is more, but say this is 1 million tons. So you can compute 10% of it is 100,000 tons. But you cannot take them from all over the place. You take them from one place or two places. So you make actually an enormous hole in the ecosystem. And that hole doesn't resemble anything that the animals do, the whales and stuff, but they are also exploited.
So you start creating
locally, you starve the entire fauna of the base of the food web. And this 2% you mentioned,
0.5.
This doesn't mean anything because it's locally. Locally, it's far more. Locally, it's 100%.
But this is really upsetting. You know, we started out all cheery and positive, saying, yeah, you know, when it comes to the waters of the Arctic and fisheries, there's every reason to believe we can get this right, and science can in a sense, guide economic exploitation in a responsible way. But now, already on the panel, we're having a debate, admittedly in the Antarctic, but it could be just as relevant to the Arctic, where it turns out, you know, the academic and the scientific input is telling you that what you claim to be responsible isn't actually responsible at all.
And I think what we're having, I think it's important that we have this discussion because you have, as I hope you would have for any regulations in the Arctic, you have several sort of safety nets to make sure that the biomass is okay. So we have smaller control areas, so we're ensuring that we don't fish anything in the same area. So we have different quotas separated out, so you move to a new area, so that you don't have that concentrated impact on one place in the ecosystem. And we're also heavily involved in research in the entire area, so we're not looking at only one biomass, you're looking at all the predators and every other species that depend on krill to make sure that you cannot say that, oh, this fish stock is okay. It doesn't work that way. You have to look at the entire ecosystem and say, this fish stock is okay, but also the other animals depending on this fish stock is okay.
Okay, well, Paul, I think you were wanting to come in. You were waving a finger in a very quizzical sort of way. What did it mean, your finger waving?
Yes. No, it means that I think it's this issue that if science can support something, or if science says, having been scientific advisor to policy processes for a large part of my lifetime, one of the obstacles to this is quite often that the political guidelines are not very clear. And UNCLOS itself is an example of that, because UNCLOS is very specific when it comes to single stock exploitation.
Hang
which
on,
is
you're going to not have to use fashion. Jargon with me or acronyms. UNCLOS is...
Oh, sorry. The UNCLOS is very specific when it comes to single stock fisheries.
UNCLOS is what?
United Nations Law of the Sea.
I knew that.
Which is the
knew.
Basis... yeah, of course you know
I
that.
Just don't do acronyms. But yeah, go on.
We don't do acronyms, yes. It's very specific on that, but when it comes to the wider impacts of the large ecosystems, it just says, take an ecosystem approach. And this is where we need policy guidelines to say, what do you mean by that? Be sure that when you, for instance, expand, if you expand into the Arctic with this, that it is taking the wider perspectives on board. And there we need to get a better dialogue, not a better dialogue, but a clear input from the political side about what is it you think is important to protect here and what we should do in terms to ensure that we do take these wider ecosystem impacts on board.
All right.
Science can advise on what these impacts may be in that dialogue, but in the end, it's not a question of just science coming up with something, because then scientists are starting to play the role of politicians, and that's not what we want.
No, it's not.
And
the politicians
society.
Will kick back at that for sure. And we've got one on the panel. So, Frank, the way this debate is going, there is a real question mark about the relationship between science and politicians.
Yep.
Here in Norway, I wonder how you see it. And in particular, I think it was Karmenu who was saying, you know, absolutely no fishing in the Arctic unless it is completely backed by science. You know, so give us your political perspective from Norway.
That's the success story of the Norwegian-Russian cooperation. That you, after a lot of years training, practicing, and debates.
By the way, I made it sound just then like you're in the EU, and as a Brit who's about to leave the EU, I should emphasize to everyone, I am aware that Norway is not actually in the EU.
I was also thinking whether I should start we had to fight those politicians claiming America first and Britain's first, but I think we don't do that. Paul is right that we have managed stock by stock, but it has been a successful model. But then we see the climate change. We now see the species are changing. We have the mackerel growing and moving.
Moving north, you mean?
North, yeah. And that's a good example that for the politicians we need to stress to use international law, because this is the framework to sustainable management and to sustainable.
When it comes to international law, are all nations truly equal, or do some nations take international law more seriously than others?
That's a very good question. Yes, we have old nations, we have new nations.
Well, in the spirit of the new approach to Arctic Council and Arctic Frontiers meetings, let's name a few names. Which countries are not, in your view, on this issue, taking international law seriously? We've got all day, so take your time.
Yeah. I start in the other end. I think those who take this seriously, and I highlight Norway, the Nordic cooperation, the good cooperation.
Yeah,
Russia.
I don't want the good. I don't want the good boys. I want the bad boys.
Yeah, and the EU, which is being better. Norway contributed to the work in
EU. I'm still waiting for an answer.
So, yeah. And then we have an interesting period ahead of us. There are rumors that some countries are leaving the EU. That could be complicated when the Scots.
So the Brits are in the bad boy category, are they? Or they could be.
Scots should talk to the Englishmen about their fish stocks.
Are there any other big nations part of the Arctic that you have in mind?
No.
All right. Okay, well, you keep your counsel if you want. Does anybody else care to contribute? I mean, it's a serious point here. If one is to take seriously the idea that adherence to international law is key to a responsible management of the Arctic, then everybody has to believe that everybody else is acting in good faith. Do we believe everybody's acting in good faith?
Well, we have a big country who had to recognize the law of the sea. Mm. That's a big task. It could be more complicated than the years to come.
Yeah. Which big country would that be?
The United States.
And how are prospects, in your view, for that right
well,
now?
Well, I'm always optimistic.
Well, the US respect the law of the sea, but they have not ratified it. And they respect it almost to the letter.
Right. Mm.
They because the Navy could not go anywhere, for example, if they didn't have innocent passage and so on. So they respect it. They do that for lots of treaties.
And they did it in their work in their chairmanship.
And the other, the other very big country that might be on people's minds, Russia, how are they doing in terms of actually sticking to...
Very good.
Very good.
Yeah.
One country that doesn't is China, as claiming part of the high seas as theirs.
Right.
That is a problem. That you wanted to, but it's not part of the Arctic.
No, but they are here, so we can perhaps reflect upon their. Good.
If just
briefly, Commissioner, because I'm going to stop you for a sec, because it's very. We haven't got that much longer, and I want to make sure everybody believes that I'm serious when I say we want contributions from the floor on questions. So we've got one here, which actually is very relevant to the Arctic and to you guys with your, you know, fisheries sort of knowledge. The question is, can fish farming and aquaculture help feed the world?
Can I answer this?
You can.
There is two kind of aquaculture.
let's call it A and B. One part, the aquaculture A is built on bivalves and herbivores fish, like carp and little fish. It produces about 80% of aquaculture in the world. This is mainly in China, in the Philippines, in India, and so on. That is food that people can get because it's produced cheaply. There is another form of aquaculture, and it's usually what we think about when we are in Europe and North America. That's Norwegian salmon and sea bass and so on. This cannot feed the world. This cannot. And in fact, the more you produce of it, the less fish you have. Because you must use fish to produce fish. Yeah. And even though people talk all the time about we are reducing the amount of fish, there is more fish going in and going out. That will remain the stuff. So it's essentially untrue that aquaculture as we conceive it, can feed the world.
Okay, well, that's a great answer, and that was very helpful to me. I'm not going to allow you, Commissioner, because we're almost out of time. And this has got to be the last question from the audience, but I'm going to ask you to respond to it. How to best include Russia more on issues of sustainable use of renewable marine resources? What are you doing, you know, particularly in the current political climate, to make sure that Russia is drawn in rather than...
I have to say that with regards to the European Union and Russia, we do still cooperate a lot when it comes to fisheries. We are partners on...
What about all your sanctions you've placed on Russia? Nothing to do with this.
No. When it comes to fisheries in common grounds, we do cooperate a lot with Norway, Russia.
You cooperate?
Yes. What I have to say to the previous question about...
Yeah, you have to be quick.
Aquaculture, I think it's not true anymore that you have to feed 3 tons of fish to get 1 ton of, it's reversed now, with 1/3. So my answer to that would be yes, as long as it is sustainable aquaculture. And science today, because aquaculture is also a science today, it has improved a lot. One comment which I would like to end with is that we think that stocks are being depleted only through fisheries. But there are other factors. There are the issue of invasive species, climate change, fish migrating patterns are changing because climate is changing. I was astonished last year when I was talking to some indigenous people in Alaska who were literally thriving on salmon. They had problems with their salmon. The salmon was getting sick because of climate change. They couldn't migrate elsewhere because they were in the river. But they said, and they told me for the very first time, and I think Dr. Pauli mentioned this, they saw tuna in their waters, which could be a new hope for them. And that is one possibility due to the fact that even because of climate change, migratory patterns of fish is also changing.
Yeah, well, our overarching theme is change in the Arctic, so thanks for that thought, and particularly fascinating discussion. Thank you, panel, for the whole thing. Thanks a lot, indeed. Thanks, Ilya. Thank you. Thank you to our panel. Don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen, because we've got another panel coming straight in, and then it's lunchtime after that. So stick with us, and then we'll all get lunch. But let's just get our second panel up here onto the stage. So again, mostly familiar figures. You've seen most of our panel before. Let me just introduce you to the two you haven't seen before. Nina Jensen is the Secretary General of World Wildlife Fund, WWF, in Norway. So welcome to you, Nina.
Thank you.
And at the other end of the panel, we have Rachel Callender, who is a managing partner at Callender and Associates. So welcome to you, Rachel. I think everybody else is a familiar... Oh, no, and you're not a familiar face, so I'll introduce you too. Do also give a welcome to Peter Haugen, who is President of the Intergovernmental Oceanographic Commission of UNESCO. That is a heck of a mouthful. How big is your business card?
I have three, actually.
Anyway, please give the whole panel a warm welcome. Right, well, we're going to continue the theme. We just get different perspectives, but the same sorts of themes. And I'm going to start, if I may, with you, Nina, as you're next to me. Having heard this debate begin about the relationship between science and politics, and also the interesting point made about the real sort of dichotomy being between short-termism and long-termism, where do you think those who make decisions about exploitation of resources in the Arctic, and particularly in the waters and fisheries, where do you think they sit right now? How would you rate their performance?
Well, unfortunately, I think they're still on the short-termism end of the spectrum, but my hope is that the Arctic can actually be a place where we get it right, where we don't have to redo the mistakes that we've done everywhere else, and where we actually do take a long-term perspective into consideration. And of course, to do that, every decision that we make on new economic activities in the Arctic, it must be based on sound science. And increasingly, we're seeing politicians and decision makers disregarding essential science to continue business as usual, basically.
In the Arctic, you're not talking globally, you're just saying
I'm talking
you have
globally.
Deep concerns.
I'm talking globally, but of course...
But you're sounding concerned about the Arctic, so I want you to tell me where you see short-termism most sort of dangerous in the Arctic context.
Well, since I'm Norwegian, let me give you a good example from Norway. In 2016, we saw record high numbers for both tourism and fisheries in Norway. These are obviously two very exciting opportunities for the northern areas and for the Arctic. But at the same time, and from the previous discussions that we've had here, the major discussion continues to be how quickly and how much of the Arctic can we open up for oil and gas development. Well, it's time for a major reality check. The Arctic is literally melting under our feet. It has major consequences and impacts on all life in the Arctic, humans and wildlife. And it's time to really take that into consideration. The science is rock solid. We need to choose a different development path, and there is no climate-safe future that involves any Arctic oil and gas development.
All right, well, you just took it off to oil and gas, but you earlier mentioned tourism and fisheries. Are you lumping them all together, or does there have to be a different approach, different set of policies for each?
No,
or are you just saying blanket all economic activity, whether it be cruise ships chuntering up the fjords or major oil and gas exploration, it's all the same, it's all got to be banned.
No, absolutely not. But I think we can't have it all. I think we need to take into consideration that the Arctic is severely impacted by human activities, particularly from issues such as climate change and ocean acidification. And as we develop new opportunities in the Arctic, it needs to be based on this recognition. So I think there are great opportunities in the Arctic, particularly around a blue future, which is the topic for this conference. But that's what we want. We want a blue future, not a black future in the Arctic. And so by using...
What does blue future mean to you?
To me, it means sustainably managing and harvesting the resources that we do have in the Arctic. Like fisheries, looking into new prospects for aquaculture, tourism, renewable energy. And one of the exciting opportunities in my mind is looking into things like kelp, growing kelp in the Arctic, which can both contribute to food production, medicines, biofuels, and it can also be a major source of sequestration of CO2. So great opportunities in the Arctic if we get it right.
Okay, thank you. Rachel, I'd love to hear your thoughts on this. I'd be very honest, and I don't know what Rachel Callender and Associates do, so perhaps you can start there and then tell me what you make of the discussion we're having.
Absolutely. So Callender and Associates, our team, is here. We are working to promote responsible development, sustainable environments, and healthy communities in the Arctic, but the far north in general. So we also produce the largest Arctic policy and economics conference in the U.S. annually. So basically the Arctic frontiers of the U.S.
Right.
At least we hope. Beautiful conference, of course.
How much interest in these issues and in the Arctic today, let's say, forget about the politics of Obama, Trump, but just generally, how important is the Arctic scene in the United States?
So, speaking personally, I know there are many U.S. officials here, they might have a different view, but as a private citizen, something that we are constantly aiming to do through the Arctic Encounter and through our company is to raise awareness. We struggle with an Arctic national identity as an Arctic nation. The United States does. That's just a fact. It's something that, as an Alaskan, and there are many Alaskans here, we're constantly beating down the doors of any hallway that might care. In Washington, D.C. and elsewhere, as a huge country, Alaska is just one part of it, and I think it's difficult. It's been difficult. It's a difficult road to raise awareness in the same way that Norwegians or other Arctic states have enjoyed.
And in terms of the debate that, you know, is a big theme already this morning about the degree to which short-termism as against long-termism is a huge danger for the Arctic, whether it be in oil and gas exploration or fisheries policy or whatever. When you look at it from the perspective of Alaska and the United States policy on its, you know, around its Arctic territory, what are you seeing?
Well, as you can imagine, as a huge country, the perspectives are very disjointed, especially right now. I know that you've been poking some fun at the things that have been happening as of recently on Friday in Washington, D.C. Much remains to be seen. I would say that the priority in Alaska is clear. Alaskans know that the Arctic is a strong priority for us. It dictates much of our future, economically and otherwise. We see climate change affecting our communities all the time. I represent about 900 fishery permit holders in the Gulf region. The impacts of climate change are affecting our fisheries as well. But I think it depends on who you ask, of course.
Okay, let's switch focus, and I don't know, Minister, if you were listening. Well, I'm sure you were listening, but what were you taking?
Almost listening to Nina.
Were you taking on board a lot of what Nina was saying? You know, because there was a very clear warning from Nina, and it was directed at people like you.
Well, but we're doing several things. We have regarding to the last discussion. It's a vision that we will develop knowledge to how to produce more food in the sea. For Norway, it's also important to develop more knowledge how to have sustainable industry in the north. Tourism, seafood, energy, and we're not only looking on oil and gas in the north. At my hometown, we're building windmills because we need the energy. We have a lot. We're not very few people there, so we have a lot of energy. We have hydropower. But we're building the windmills. We're looking on industry. Could we produce hydrogen to transport this to other parts of the world where they need it?
But take one example, tourism, for example. Yeah. Where do you put the limits? You know, because that's in essence part of the point, isn't it? You want to open up your territory. You want economic development and growth for your people. You want young people to have jobs in their own communities. Mm-hmm. Tourism's one great way of delivering that. Mm-hmm. But how do you decide how much before it becomes a real threat to the environment and to the very essence of the place that you're trying to open up?
Yeah, we trust in science, and we put together the brightest heads. The polar code, which represented, is one part of it. How to transport people in the Arctic in a sustainable and safe way. We also had a discussion in small communities. How many could we receive? And what to show them, and in which way. We are discussing this all the time, and we're creating rules to doing this.
Well, I'm so glad that seamlessly I can go to an SMS question, because you just mentioned the polar codes again, and I know Mr. Lim from the IMO was talking about the polar codes. Question, does the polar code go far enough, and could it ever include emissions quotas, presumably, emissions as well?
Thank you for that point. Actually, we have another the environment convention, which is MARPOL convention. Annex 6, we deal with emission issues. So we have been strengthening emission issues based on MARPOL Annex 6. So we will expect that they will create a lot of benefit in terms of emission. But at the moment, when it comes to polar coat, it touch upon environmental emission issues. But based on the MARPOL convention, that is adding to some extent. So for time being, we are concentrating implementation of MARPOL Annex 6 in terms of emission issues, climate change issues. Then having experienced some based on experience of navigation in Arctic area, then we would develop some more than the current polar cold. That is our point.
We had some debate earlier about the expansion of shipping in the far north, in the Arctic seas. What's your view from the IMO about how quickly and how far that expansion of shipping routes can go?
But actually, IMO is not the position whether we promote navigation through Arctic area or not. It's not our mandate. However, when there is a shipping, is increasing to navigate in the Arctic area, we have to take care of the safety and environment issues.
No, I know. But based on what you hear from your membership and from the big countries involved in international and global shipping, do you see the far north becoming a more and more strategically important sort of area for shipping?
Based on the development in that area, we it is expected that the number of ships and the volume of ships would increase in the future. We will not say definitely about what will be increased, about when, but definitely there will be increased, including the cruise ships. So we have to be very cautious about the securing safety and development issues.
Mm. I mean, Peter, I should bring you in at this point. What's your insight into what you're hearing on this panel and what you've heard so far in this conference?
Well, I think there are several comments I could make, but looking into the Arctic here, we have some parts which are national jurisdiction and some which are beyond national jurisdiction. And I think when we talk about science policy interface and how to deal with that, those two things are different.
Yeah.
And there is a process going on, I don't think it has been mentioned here today, on the biological biodiversity in areas beyond national jurisdiction, which is the formal name. A UN General Assembly decision to make actually a legally binding instrument there.
So put that into the most simplistic layman's language for me. What's the significance of that?
So the thing is that up to now, member states have decided on, for example, marine protected areas in their own national waters.
Yeah.
The question is, how do we deal with the international waters coming to that? And that's my point, that then science policy interface cannot only be national, it has to be really global.
Exactly. That comes back to this issue of good faith and whether, all of the stakeholders, sorry to use such a terrible word, but whether they're all coming at this with the same sort of shared values and good faith.
Science policy society interface as well. And we have another concept, ocean literacy. We try to educate people about the issues in the ocean. That's quite important to have a meaningful political debate as well about these issues.
Mm.
And then we have to address that fact that the Arctic is not a homogeneous area because of the Gulf Stream. This is an active part of the Arctic, but the European part of the Arctic isn't like Alaska and Siberia. It's ice-free waters and have been traffic for several years.
Yeah, I feel a very desperate urge to get the view from space at this point. I don't know why.
The advantage is that we don't care about national borders because we fly above them. So there's only one border in the world we can see from space, and no other one. So therefore, this is really, really the beauty of space.
We don't
have to take care of all of these different issues. By the way, also in our day-to-day work, ESA with 22 member states plus Canada plus Slovenia, there is already this international understanding day by day. And by the way, also, it was interesting when we addressed this field of Arctic in a discussion, immediately Austria said, we want to be part of it. Mm. I was a little bit surprised first. And then Portugal mentioned. And this is also strange. And we found out at least it's the 3A, Arctic, Alps, and Atlantic. But you see, in that there is something in, because we are all saying about that it has an interconnection, all of this. And this comes back then also to, if we want to have a sustainable solution, which means that we are doing something which is not preventing the future, meaning it comes from forest. Huh? You only harvest as much which is comes from again in the future. So therefore, in
and
this
the same with fish, as we discussed with the scientists.
Yeah, if you do it in the right way, but in a sustainable way, then you don't harm the situation, but then you support the situation.
Well, that you must have been reading that screen
by accident.
The screen. The question from the audience is: there is lots of talk here about sustainability, but how would you panelists actually define it? You just did yes. quite a good job. Does anybody else want to give a definition of sustainability? And because it's the word that is always invoked repeatedly at conferences like this, particularly I would imagine about something like the Arctic and the future of the Arctic. What do you mean by sustainability?
Well, I think currently there's a lot of greenwashing of the term sustainability, and everything is now supposed to be sustainable or green. You have green coal, you have green oil and gas, you have, I mean, pretty much everything is green and sustainable, which is not true, obviously. For things to be sustainable, it has to not degrade the planet. It has to not remove more resources that can actually be reproduced. And currently we are far from being sustainable. If you take the oceans as we are discussing, over the past 40 years, life in the oceans has been reduced by more than 40%. If we reach anywhere close to 1.5 degrees global warming, coral reefs are a history. We are over-harvesting and putting too many pressures on the oceans and on the other ecosystems, and it's far from sustainable.
But, I mean, this sounds like a silly point, but do people at an Arctic conference need to worry about the future of coral reefs in Australia?
Of course they do, and coral reefs aren't only found in Australia. They're also found in Norway. Norway actually has the world's largest cold water coral reef, and it's a hugely important area for fisheries because a lot of the fish actually come from there. That's their nursery ground. That's where they grow up, basically. So if we lose coral reefs, if we lose the major habitats or spawning areas for fish, then where do we get all the glorious opportunities that we want to explore in this area?
Good. Well, that comprehensively was a very stupid question then, so that's good. I warned you it might be. Another question on SMS. What are some of the main bottlenecks for the sustainability principle actually being put into practice? Anybody want to take that?
There's, of course, the short-term necessity to react, and we heard it this morning also, that usually people are very much aware of the next day or the next week or the next years, but sustainability in this respect must look into a much longer perspective, and this is of course a bottleneck.
Yeah.
And to add to that, I think one of the major hurdles is, of course, that politicians and decision makers elegantly disregard science and make decisions anyway, regardless of, you know, whether it's fisheries scientist or climate scientist, whatever, telling the decision makers that, you know, this is wrong. You're over-harvesting or you're putting too much emissions out in the atmosphere, then you're disregarding it and you're continuing with business as usual. So disregarding of science is a major problem to achieve sustainability.
Yeah, Frank, are you in the habit of disregarding science?
Nope. I'm not. You want a longer answer?
Because I'm interested, what's the relationship, you know, in your, I don't know whether your ministry would be one of the most sort of at the coalface, at the interface between science and policy, but I would imagine you must have scientific advice coming over your desk every single day, and I'm sure many of your ministerial colleagues do too. Mm. You know, just try and explain for us, those of us who are not politicians in government, how you develop a relationship with the scientists and their scientific advice.
Well, in my portfolio, I mostly have the responsibility for Norwegian scientists to cooperate with EU scientists, for example.
Right.
And we have a great project on microplastic. That's one part of it. The other part is to ensure that my colleagues in the government are familiar with those programs and that we are using it on all sectors. That's my part. It's also always a discussion whether you trust scientists or not. I think in Norway we have a very good cooperation with the scientists, and I think we have some good results to prove it. And we're working for fish stocks. We used to manage stock by stock. We're not now working on a model for multi-stock management. It's important to see how this affect the other stocks.
You would recognize the tension, short-termism against long-termism.
Yeah.
And politician,
yeah.
I mean, I don't know how you're doing electorally and how your poll ratings are, but...
We're elected for 4 years. We're better on that the first 3 years than we are the...
That's for sure, yeah.
Yes, I would like to mention something. It's not only the politicians listening to the scientists, but of course it's also the scientists providing the information to the politicians in the right way, so that also not only the politicians, but also that the public is aware of that. Because otherwise the politicians are very alone if they do something
right.
where the public is not following, and their space comes into the thing. For instance, if you talk about rainforests or, for instance, about the ice shield, very similar things. If you see just a tree falling down, then you have no idea about whether the rainforest is going smaller or bigger. If you see just an ice part breaking apart from the ice shield, what does it mean? But if you have a global view on that, then you can see and then you can communicate from science to politics, and then it gets to some awareness and to some
actions. It's a very good point about the public. Do you think the public, and particularly if we're talking about, you know, Arctic issues and Arctic nations, that the publics of these countries in particular are much more aware, much better informed, more prioritizing, you know, these issues of sustainability and responsibility than they perhaps were 20, 30 years ago?
For sure.
Yeah.
But we have developed democratic developed countries in the Nordic. I'm talking for. We have highly trusted the politicians and the
highly trusted politicians.
The people trust the politicians. Yeah,
they do.
Yeah.
In Norway. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure many here are Norwegian, and you're all nodding enthusiastically.
Nodding. Mm-hmm. No, but that's true, and well.
No, I mean, I think Jeffrey Sachs said...
That's the Nordic model.
Nordic model, Jeffrey Sachs said he loves you on the whole, except for what you'd say on fossil fuels. But anyway, did you want to say something, Rachel?
Yeah, just to point out on that note, though, in regards to politicians, I think that reasonable politicians who are in the job for the right reasons, are forced on a daily basis to listen to their constituents. And I don't know a single constituent who's a commercial fisherman or lives in the Arctic who is anti-good science. Mm. I've never heard of that. I mean, that is the opposite of sustainability. But on the flip side of that, I know that, and some of my colleagues from Alaska, the northern part of Alaska, are here. They feel a sense of frustration when all these conversations about green sustainability come up over and over again, when they feel that these policies are being put into place potentially to turn them into a snow globe. That is said pretty frequently in Alaska.
What do you mean a snow? I'm not getting
a snow globe. With you shake it up and you look at it and you say, "Isn't that so pretty?" But people live there, and people have to have jobs. Mm. They have to have economies, and that is also sustainability.
Mm. I just wanted to say a few things in relation to trust and politicians, because I think in being a Norwegian, there is a high level of trust in politicians here. And I would also like to emphasize that politicians in Norway, to a large extent, listens to science. Mm. And that has also led to us being among the world leaders when it comes to sustainable fisheries. But it's also interesting to note that on other areas where we're not getting the scientific answer that we want, we're increasingly asking for more science so that we can actually get the right answer or the politician answer,
right.
Which is really surprising, you know, like in an area like the Lofoten Islands, which is a hot topic in Norway where they want to start oil and gas development. We have more than 90 reports describing the unique values in this area. But the scientists or the politicians are still saying, no, we need more science because, you know, there may be some loophole in there somewhere that allows us to do it sustainably. There is none. Just stop the discussion. Listen to the science.
That's not the correct picture, but that's okay.
I was so happy that everything in Norway was fine, and now maybe it's not quite fine. But Peter, you're going to get the last word because we're almost out of time. Go on.
Another issue very relevant for the Arctic is ocean acidification, which comes from CO2 emissions to the atmosphere. And you know, it's 20 years ago that we knew that this was happening. We had published papers on it. But only last year or so, we began to get really papers showing that there are strong impacts, for example, on cod larvae, on things that people care about. It takes a long time for these kind of scientific messages to get through to the public as well, and then also to the politicians. The only solution to ocean acidification is reduced CO2 emissions, and that's a threat to the Arctic environment.
Well, that's something that has hung over much of our discussion this morning. I'm going to stop our discussion at this point because our time is up. It is almost lunchtime. Ladies and gentlemen, I've really enjoyed my morning because I think, you know, the discussion has been in the right spirit, but we haven't, I hope, dodged some very significant challenges. And this whole question of science and policy making and the tensions between the two, the perspective of the short term, which of course politicians have to embrace, but also the importance of truly long-term thinking as well. There are all sorts of challenges here which are so relevant to future policy making in the Arctic. We're going to keep digging away at this afternoon, but right now it's time to thank the panel and invite you all to get your lunch. So thank you very much.